So, hello students, we are going to see string in Python programming. So, what is the string? First, we will see. String is an ordered sequence of characters. Okay? It is a collection of characters, or it is a ordered sequence of characters. Now, we are going to see some operators in the string. In string, we have plus operator, we have minus operator, we have membership operator. There are n number of operators. First, starting with these operators, we will see how to declare a string and how to print that string in Jupyter Notebook. So I am opening a Jupyter Notebook. So here I am with the Jupyter Notebook. We are going to see, suppose I want to declare a string. Now how to do that? I am taking one variable a is equal to, inside the quotes, I am writing the string. Okay. You can use single quotes or double quotes to write the string, but compulsory you have to write it into a quotes only. Now I want to print that string. So I am writing print a. So when I will run the code, it is getting me an output hello. Similarly, you can write a sentence as well. I am writing the sentence. Okay, see, I have written one sentence and I want to print that sentence. So I'm just writing print A. I'm getting the output. This is how we can declare a string and we can print a string. Now we are going to see the operators in string. So in the string, we have an operator plus operator. Now, what is this plus operator in string? Now see, the plus operator concatenates the string. What is meaning of concatenation? So concatenation is nothing but joining two strings together. So plus operator in string helps us to concatenate two strings, means to join the two strings. Let's see this with the example. See, now I am taking one string as hello and another string as students. Okay. So now if I'm writing in a print function x plus y, what it will do? It will concatenate the two strings. That means it will join the two words, that is hello and students. See, when I run the code, I'm getting the output hello students together. It is joining the two words together. So plus operator in the string means concatenation of string. That means joining the two strings together. If I'm using comma instead of plus operator, if I'm using comma, then it will just help me to print those words. But if I am using plus operator, that means it will join the two strings together. So joining is nothing but concatenation, and this is the plus operator in string helps us to join the two strings together. So this is one of the operator in string. Then we have a second operator, that is multiplication operator. Now what it does, this does. So this operator creates multiple copies of string. Let's see how it creates a multiple copies of string. Now I'm taking one variable s, and I'm in that variable in I'm writing kit. Okay, I've taken one word, one string kit inside a variable s. I am writing print s into 2. So when I will run the code, see the output I'm getting is kit. This means दैट स्ट्रिंग इज प्रिंटिंग टू टाइप्स टू टाइम, ओके, एस इंटू टू. तो इंटू ऑपरेशन ब्रिंग सम मल्टीपल कॉपीज. इफ आई राइट एस इंटू थ्री इट विल प्रिंट थ्री टाइम्स. इफ आई एम राइटिंग एस इंटू फाइव इट विल प्रिंट फाइव टाइम्स. सो दिस मल्टीपल मल्टीप्लाई ऑपरेशन हेल्प्स अस टू क्रिएट अ मल्टीपल कॉपीज. सो दिस इज वन ऑफ द ऑपरेटर वी आर यूजिंग इन स्ट्रिंग, दैट इज मल्टीप्लीकेशन. नाउ द नेक्स्ट ऑपरेटर वी हैव इज मेंबरशिप ऑपरेटर. दिस इज वेरी इम्पॉर्टेंट ऑपरेटर इन पाइथन प्रोग्रामिंग, दैट इज मेंबरशिप ऑपरेटर. नाउ इन द मेंबरशिप ऑपरेटर वी हैव टू टाइप्स. द फर्स्ट इज इन ऑपरेटर एंड द सेकेंड इज नॉट इन ऑपरेटर. नाउ लेट सी वॉट इज दिस इन ऑपरेटर फ्रॉम मेंबरशिप ऑपरेटर. द इन ऑपरेटर रिटर्न्स ट्रू इफ द फर्स्ट ऑपरेंड इज कंटेन्ड विद इन द सेकेंड. नाउ वॉट इज वॉट डज दिस मीन्स. इफ द फर्स्ट वर्ड इज इन द सेकेंड वर्ड लाइक सेकेंड स्ट्रिंग देन इट विल रिटर्न ट्रू, अदरवाइज इट विल रिटर्न फॉल्स. लेट्स सी विद द एग्जाम्पल. सी नाउ आई एम टेकिंग वन वेरिएबल एज एक्स इज इक्वल टू आई एम राइटिंग फूड. ओके आई एम राइटिंग वन स्ट्रिंग एज फूड. नाउ आई एम राइटिंग एस इन. ओके सी हाउ आई एम राइटिंग एस इन. आई एम टेकिंग वन सेंटेंस. Now see, I have written x is equal to food and then I have written s in the another sentence. That means whether the value of s is present into the another sentence, another string. If it is present, it will return true, else it will return false. Okay, so see, here I have taken x is equal to food. Now I am just printing x in then the another sentence. So if the x value is present in this sentence, it will return true. Otherwise, it will return false. Okay, I have taken x as a variable and I have assigned a value food, that is a string. Now I am just printing x in. Then the another sentence, another string I have written. So if the value of x is present in the another sentence, then it will return true. Otherwise, it will return false. Let's see the another member function, that is not in. So the same code I am writing. Instead of in, I am using not in. Not in is one of the operator. That is a membership operator. We have two types of membership operator. One is in and another is not in. So now we will see the same code. See, the output I am getting is false. Not in means if it is present, it will return true. And if we are using a not in means if it will be a reverse of in operator. In, if it is present, we are using in. If it is present but we don't want it, then it will return a false. So this is a not in operator. In operator, if it is present, and the reverse of that, that is not in operator. I have written, suppose the value of x I am writing as g, that is good. So what it will search, whether good is not present in this sentence. So if you observe the sentence, that is the food for the day. This was the sentence. In that, there is no good word. So it will return a value true. x not in this. Yes, x is not in this, so it is printing true. And if I am using food, and it will printing false because x is there. Is there, right? The value of x is present inside this sentence, so it is printing false. Not in means that value is not in that sentence. The value food is not in that sentence, so it is returning false because the value of x is already there inside the another sentence. If I change the value, it is present giving me an output as true because yes, that x value is not present in that sentence. So these are the two membership operator, in and not in. I will repeat again. In, we are using the in membership operator when that word is present in another sentence, it will return true. If that is not present, it will return false. In the not in operator, if we are using a not in membership operator, we are checking that the value of x is not in that sentence, is not in the another string. So we will just write x not in the sentence. Or we can also write, see, I am taking A is equal to I am from India. And another sentence, another string as I am learning in India. Okay. So now, whether we have want to check the word is present in that or not, you can simply write A in B. So it is giving me false because really A sentence is different and B sentence is different. There is no match in between A and B. Okay. And if I write not in, then it will return true because yes, the two A and B sentences are different. But if I'm writing the same statement for B, and when I run the code, it is giving me false because A not in B. No, A is in B, right? So if I'm using instead of not, I'm using in, then it will display true because two sentences are same. So this is how we are going to use in operator and membership operator. You can use like this by just passing a value and putting it into another string. Or you can take two another variables and check the value. Suppose I am writing, I'm taking one another value as C is equal to India. Now I'm using A in C. Okay. So it is giving me false. So if I'm using A not in C, it is giving me true. So this is also a valid statement. Or simply you can use A in, you can write the another sentence, India. Okay. So if I run it, it is giving me false because if you observe, A is the another string and this string is different. So it is giving me an output. If I am writing C in India, like C having a string as India, we want to check whether that is present in this or not. It is giving me true because India is present in this sentence, right? There is a India word present. Similarly, if I am writing C in A, it is giving me true because C value, that is India, is present in A value. Okay. Similarly, if I am using not in, it will give me a false because note India is present in A, so it is giving me an answer as false. So these are the two membership operator in and not in. We are using in operator. If the string one is present in string two, it will return true. Otherwise, it will return false. Another is not in membership operator means we are saying the first string is not in the second string. If really the first string is not present into a second string, then it will return true. Otherwise, it will return false. So this is the membership operators in and not in. Now, next we are going to see string built-in functions. So there are some string in the string there are some built-in functions which helps us to do our task. So what are those functions? Now, the first function is CHR. What is this CHR? It converts an integer to a character. So we'll see what is this. Now, for every word or every character, for every character, there is a unique integer number assigned. Okay, there is a unique code assigned for every character, for every letters, for symbols. Okay, there is a unique code assigned, and that is called as ASCII value. That means American code for information interchange. American standard code for information interchange, ASCII value. ASCII value, ASCII value means ASCII. That stands for American Standard Code for Information Interchange. This unique code is assigned for every letters. There will be a unique code for letter A. There will be a unique code for letter B. Likewise, for every letter, there is a unique code assigned. And even for a digits, there is a unique code assigned. So whatever the keys you found on a keyboard, for every key, there is a unique code assigned by American Standard Code for Information Interchange, ASCII value. We call it as an ASCII value. That unique code is called as ASCII value. Now, we have to find out that unique code. Now, suppose you want to find out the unique code for integer numbers like 0 to 9, okay, for digits. If you want to find out the unique code, then we will use the function CHR. Now, see this example. I have written S is equal to CHR inside the bracket 65. So, whenever I will write a number, it will display me the letter attached to that number. It will display a letter attached to that number. And the reverse of that is if I am using a letter and I want to find out the unique code for that, I will use ORD function. ORD. Okay, that it converts a character to an integer. Let's see this with an example. Now see, I'm writing A is equal to ORD of small a in quotes you have to give, okay? And I'm just printing A. Now see, the value of A is 97. Even you can simply use ORD of B. It is giving 98. I'm just finding the unique values, unique code of the letters, okay? So unique code of the letter is C. ORD of Z. So starting from 97 number to 122, we have an alphabet A to Z. Again, there will be a unique code for capital A. See, the unique code for capital A is 65, and the unique code for small a was 97. Okay, so we have just finding out the unique code assigned for an alphabets. I'm also finding capital Z. Now you will observe capital A is having 65, whereas capital Z is having 90. Small a is having unique code 97, and small z is having a code 122. Okay, so this is how you can find out the unique codes of that alphabets. Now, if you know the unique code and you want to find out the alphabet attached to that unique code, then we have a CHR function. So just write CHR 122. Now see, it is giving me a value Z. Okay. From integer to character, use CHR. From character to integer, use ORD function. Similarly, if I want to find the value attached to a 65, then it is giving me A. So this is the difference between CHR and ORD. These are the functions helps us to give the unique code which is assigned to every keys. Okay, so with the help of this function, we can find out the values. Now see, I have written a symbol ORD hashtag. Okay, in the quotes I have written this hash symbol. Then the value of that is 35. Let's see which value of 33 is. So I'm writing CHR inside that 33. So see, it is exclamatory mark. Okay. If it is a numeric, just write the numbers here inside CHR. If you want to find out the alphabets, then just write it into an quotes and then write the alphabet using ORD function. So this is the difference between ORD and CHR. ORD function helps us to give me an integer value, whereas CHR function give me the alphabet assigned to that value. It converts integer to character, and ORD converts character to integer. So this is the major difference between ORD and CHR. Both helps us to give the unique code. So this is the some built-in functions. Okay, let's find the code for 07. 07, like 7 is the another one. See, this is something for a 7. Again, if you want to find out the 0, it is something this value. So these are the maybe a blank spaces or whatever. Every unique number will have some value. So this is how we are going to find out. So this is how we will get the output. If you search on internet ASCII value chart, you will get all the chart of numbers. You can cross-check whether we have got a correct number or not, or correct alphabet or not. Now, the another function is length function. We can find out the length of string. For example, I am writing A is equal to hello, hello. And in the print function, I am writing print A. It will get me hello. But I also want to find out the length of that string. So I am writing print len inside the bracket A. So now see, it is giving me an output 5, the length of that string. So we have a len function to find out the length of string, and this is also one of the built-in function. So three functions we have seen: CHR, ORD, and length function. Now, if I want to find out the type means data type of that variable, that is A, I will write print inside that type in the bracket A. So now see, it is giving me a string type. So type is also one of the built-in function. So these are some built-in functions used in string. Now next we are going to see is string indexing. Now what is this string indexing? This is also one of the important thing in string. So in programming languages, individual items in an ordered set of data can be accessed directly using a numeric index or a key value. And this process is called as indexing. Means, suppose if I have a word, hello world, okay, hello world, and I only want to fetch hello. So if you want to fetch the part of the string that is called as indexing, or any character, any single character, then it is called as a indexing. So in Python, string are sequence of character data, and thus we can index the strings. So individual characters in a string can be accessed by specifying string name followed by a square brackets. Let's see this with an example. Now see, suppose I have one string. Python programming. Okay, this is my one string. And I just want to find out the letter at 0th index. Okay, now I will show you how this works. Now see, suppose I have some letter written. Okay, this is one of my string. Now this H will be at 0th position. This E will be at 1st position. This L will be at 2nd position. This L will be at 3rd position. And this 0 will be at, like O will be at 4th position. Okay, this is how the position start from. It start from 0th index to the last index. And if we are going reverse, then the reverse first word will start at minus 1. This will be at minus 2 position. This will be at minus 3 position. Okay, if we are going reverse, then it will start from minus. And if we are giving forward, it starts from 0th position. Now, we want to find the value at 0th position. So how to write that? See, in the print function, just write A and square bracket inside that gives 0. So when I run the code, it is giving me P. Why P? Because at the 0th position, I have a value P. Similarly, if I want to find the value at 1st position, I will write 1. It is giving me Y. Okay. Similarly, if I want to find the value at 4th position, it is giving me O. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. At the 4th position, I have 0. Similarly, if I want to find the value at 5th position, I have N. Okay. If I want to find the value at 6th position, it is blank because there is a space. Space is also calculated. If I am writing 7, it is giving me again P. P is at 7th location. This is how we can find out the location of each letter, and this is called as indexing. We can fetch the part of the string or character from the string, and this is called as indexing in Python programming. Now, if I'm going reverse, then I will need to write minus 1. Now, see, I'm getting the output G because I'm going reverse. So if you want to find out the last word, last index, it is at minus 1. Okay. Then if I write minus 2, it is giving me N. So if we are going from reverse, then just write minus 1. If you want to find out the last word, then last second, then last third. Similarly, write minus 1, minus 2, minus 3. Okay. So this is called as indexing, string indexing. Okay, so these are some examples of string indexing. Now, if I want to find out the length of string, I will just write len inside the bracket, the variable. And I want to find the length minus 1. So length minus 1 means if I am having a length 5, then 5 minus 1, that will display the variable. Let's see that also. See now, I am taking one string as hello, and I am print length of A minus 1. Now, see, the output I am getting is 4 because length minus 1, how many length I have? That is 5. So 5 minus 1 is 4. Okay, so this is how we can make the subtraction of the length as well. So this is a simple example of string indexing. Now, next we are going to see is string slicing. So what is this string slicing? One thing remember, in the indexing, space is also considered. If you are writing A space B, then there will be A at 0th position, space will be at 1st position, B will be at 2nd position. So space is also considered. Now next we are going to see is string slicing. Indexing was nothing but fetching one letter. Now what is slicing? Slicing allows to extract substring. Okay, if we have one string and I want to find a part of it, means I want to find some substring, I want to fetch some substring, it is called as a string slicing. And here we have a syntax. See, it is mentioned in this PPT. S in the bracket, M is to N. M and N are the first and the last letters of the substring, and S is my main string. I will show you with an example what is string slicing. Now see, I am taking one string Python programming. Now I want to only fetch the word Python. So I will write print A inside the bracket, P was at 0th position, and C, now N is at which position? 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6th position. So I will write 0 to 6. So when I run the code, I am getting the output as Python. That means from the one string, I am fetching the substring, sub part of it. Python is one of the part of the string, right? I am fetching that part. So this is what is called as slicing. Okay, fetching the sub part of it is called as slicing. Similarly, if I am writing 2 to 6, then the output I am getting is THON only, because at the second position it is 2. Okay, if I am writing 8, 15. Okay, see, now I'm getting this part. So only the some part of the string we can fetch it. The first value indicates the first location, like which location from starting location of that substring, and the last field or the last value indicates the last location of the substring from which to where you want. You have to mention that. This is called as string slicing. Now if I'm writing minus 1 is to minus 8 or 9, let's see which what output I get. At minus 9 it is a space. Okay, so this is what, this is how we can use the slicing. Mostly in the slicing go from forward only, like 7 to 15 I'm getting an output program. Okay, if I'm right 14 I'm getting an output program. So this is how we can fetch a substring from a string, and this is called as string slicing. So this was all about string. We have learned what is string. String is a sequence of characters. Then we have seen the string built-in functions, that is CHR, ORD, which helps us to find out the ASCII value. Then we have seen the length of the string, type function, which helps us to give the data type. Then we have seen string indexing and string slicing. So this is all about the string in Python programming. Now, the next we are going to see is string comparison. So let's see what is this string comparison. Now, in the string comparison, we are going to compare two strings. See how to do that. If I want to compare two strings, okay, I'm writing print in double quotes, I'm writing hello is equal to hello. So we know that it is not equal, it is equal. This hello is equal to this hello. So I'm getting the output as true. If I'm changing the second string to another something, it is giving me false. Means the first hello, like first string, is not equal to second string. So it is giving me a Boolean value false. Okay. Similarly, if I'm writing print hi greater than another string hi, again I'm getting the output as false, because in the string we cannot say which one is greater. Okay, so it is giving me false. The same part, if I'm using the less than operation, it will give me true. What it does is, it will find out the ASCII value of high and ASCII value of this high. Okay. This means, ASCII value par nahi. What it will see is, there is two positions, only two locations, 0 and 1 at high. And this high will have 4. The HIEE length is 4. And this high length is 2. So 2 is less than 4. Right. The 2 is less than 4. So it is giving me true. If I am writing this high is greater than, I am getting false. Because 2 is less than 4. See, simple example I will show you. If I am using print inside that hello. And the another is I am writing programming. Now, if you observe that, the length of hello will be 5 and the length of programming will be 9. Okay. So it will see 5 greater than 9 and it will print the result. Now 5 is greater than 9. No. So I'm getting answer false. If I'm using like this, then I will get the output as true because yes, 9 is greater. Okay. 5 is less than 9. Yes, 5 is less than 9. So I am getting the output true. It will find the length of the string. Okay. It will see how much the length is. And according to that, I will get a Boolean value. So this is how we can work with the Boolean values in string. Now, next we are going to see is Boolean data type. Now, as we have seen the integer data type, floating data type, string data type, similarly, we have a Boolean data type, which represents two values, either true or false. So let's see that. I'm writing A is equal to true. Okay. And if I want to find out the data type with the help of type function, I'm just writing print type inside the bracket A. So when I will run the code, I'm getting the output as class bool. So bool is one of the data type in Python programming, which helps us to give the Boolean value, whether true or false. So this is the Boolean data type in Python programming. Now we are going to see is Boolean variable. Now what is this Boolean variable? So in a Boolean variable, there are references, one of two values, that is true or false. So if you are setting some Boolean value to a variable, it is called as a Boolean variable. Now here in the programming, this A will be called as Boolean variable because this A is having a Boolean value. So any variable which is having a Boolean value, we will call it as a Boolean variable. Okay. Let's take one example of that Boolean variable. Suppose I want to see whether the employee's salary is greater than 1000. Okay. I want to see whether the employee salary is greater than 1000. So if the employee salary is greater than 1000, the criteria for loan I will set to true. Else I will set the criteria for loan false. See how I will do that. I'm taking one employee salary as a data type and I'm taking it from a user. So I'm writing int input function. Okay. Now I'm saying if salary is greater than 1000. Okay. If salary is greater than 1000. I will put a criteria for loan is equal to true. Else, I'm writing criteria for loan is equal to false. Now see, what I did is, I have taken one salary as a variable. In that, I have taken a user input. Now, whatever the user will input his salary, if that is greater than 1000, I have taken one another variable, criteria for loan, and that I have assigned to true. I have assigned a Boolean value. So now this criteria for loan is my Boolean variable. If you are assigning Boolean value to a Boolean variable, it is called as a Boolean variable. So here in my case, criteria for loan is a Boolean variable, and I have assigned a value true to it. So when I run the code, see now, it is giving me one box. I'm writing some value. I'm writing 2000. So when I hit enter, okay, it is true. So correct. Again, I need to print the criteria for loan here. So I will just print my criteria for loan value here. Okay. So whenever I will run the code, I am putting 2000. It is giving me true. Why true? Because yes, the value is greater than 2000. So now the criteria loan value will be true. Okay. So now I want to print. If the employer is eligible for loan, then only I want to print you are eligible for loan. I want to print that. Now see how I am writing. Based on the Boolean value, okay, if Boolean value is equal to true, okay, I will print you are eligible for loan. Now see, I run the code. I'm giving the value as 2000. It is giving me true, you are eligible for loan. So based on the Boolean variable, I'm getting some output. So this is how we can use a Boolean variable. You have to assign a Boolean value to a Boolean variable. Okay, any variable if you are assigning true or false, that variable will called as Boolean variable. So this is the simple program using Boolean variable. I repeat this program again. I have taken one salary as an input. Now, whatever the user will put salary, if that salary is greater than 1000, automatically the criteria for loan value will be set to true. And if it is true, then it will print you are eligible for loan. Now, if the salary is not greater than 1000, the criteria for loan variable will set to false. And if it is false, then he will not eligible for loan. So this is the simple example of Boolean variable. And these Boolean variables are also called as flag. It is called as flag. If you are setting some Boolean value to a variable, it is called as flag. 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 It is called as flag. So flag is a variable that signals when some condition exists in a program. Remember this. Now, another program we are going to see is of password crack. Okay. How to see whether the user is trying to log in. If his password is correct, he will enter the login. Now see how to do that. Password crack program. So see now, I'm taking input from a user as password. Okay. That will be into a string format, so I'm not type converting in. I'm just put password input. Okay. Then I'm writing if my password is equal to KIT. You see the logic I have written, writing. If password is equal to KIT, I will print login success. Login successfully. Okay. Else, I want to print wrong password, try again. Now see, when I run the code, I got one box. In that box, if I'm putting ABC, okay, it is saying wrong password, try again. Similarly, if I put KIT, it is saying login successfully. So this is how we can design a login page in Python programming. You can take a name, a username, You have to set some username and set some password like this, and you can check the conditions. And if the username and password is correct, we will pass it to a successful statement. If username and login is password is not correct, we will pass it to a wrong password. So this program, simple programs you can do using string operations.